This is your first time playing with guns, isn't it?
No, we played with Guns N' Roses before as well.
So this is kind of like an old friend thing, sort of?
Absolutely not. I'm happy to see Metallica and all. They're a bunch of good guys. A lot of fun.
But having problems with Guns N' Roses?
No problems at all. Being treated quite well, actually.
Yeah, everything going good so far in the first part of the tour?
Yeah, everything went great.
Have you ever been on a stadium tour before?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, this last tour we did with Guns N' Roses was a European stadium tour. We did part of a stadium tour with Metallica as well. We did Billy Idol, Robert Plant. We're old hands at this, man.
So let's see your Stadium Masters now.
Stadium Masters, that's
exactly.
Right.
Faith No More, Stadium Masters.
Like, we open up for just about every band, but we just can't figure out how to do it ourselves, so we're probably destined to repeat this for at least another 30 years.
Right now, let's play a video from Faith No More. Here it is, Epic.
Check it out. If the show is coming to your town, get your tickets quick, because tickets are probably sold out. I know that in Washington, D.C. like this, Montreal, Canada, Pasadena, California, in my hometown, San Diego, California, tickets are all sold out. So if there's an opportunity for you to get tickets when this show comes to your town, get them immediately.
This was the first gig we've done in America. Today was the first gig with this record. We did the tour in Europe with those gentlemen and 2 months or so worth of dates, and played new songs, seven new songs a night, and kind of worked them in, you know, a little bit like a baseball mitt.
Were you going on stage playing some of the new songs, trying to see which ones worked, and did you come off stage saying, let's not do that one and let's do this one next time, or are you going to do a lot of the same new stuff live?
That's kind of tricky because we have a certain amount of time. There's stuff that we want to do. Those generally are the songs that we end up trying first, or the songs that we want to do. There's a couple of songs on the new record, like say Jizzlobber or whatever, things like that, that are a little heavier that we want to try.
Because I like the aggressive.
Yeah, we've been doing that in the headline shows, actually. When we've been doing a longer set, that was the first one that we threw in. Other stuff like Small Victory and Malpractice and Everything's Ruined is probably going to come later, too. But we just really haven't had the time to do everything. You know, as it is, I think, doing seven songs new out of, what, 14 or so. You know, that's a pretty high ratio anyway, so, you know, it's but it works, yeah. So you ask about how does it work. Everything has worked fine. Everybody's been real responsive and stuff. You know, it's been good.
Okay, well, thanks a lot, and good luck with the rest of the tour. And right now, let's play a video from another band that's part of this massive, massive summer tour. Here's Metallica. Extravaganza. That was the word I was looking for. Here's one from Metallica.
Ricky Rackman here above RFK in Washington, D.C. The place is totally packed. Listen, I want to tell you, like, a couple things. If you are going to the show, it's summer.
Faith No More, and Metallica's on 6:45, so now, really for us, man.
Yeah. Now, how's everything going? Because I imagine that there's a lot of things that you kind of have to work out, especially this being the first show of the tour. Is everything going pretty smooth?
Well, we'll find out once you walk out on stage. I mean, my main concern is whether or not, you know, the songs and the set list will work in this sort of situation, and whether, you know, all the equipment's together. And, you know, we have a new stage set up, and we still haven't played on it yet. This is, like, you know, it's a new thing, so we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, one thing I've been saying throughout the couple days is that you had two full stages that were set up, when in fact I just found out there's three complete stages that are set up. And do you know how that whole thing works?
I think that Faith No More goes on with just, you know, their regular back line and stuff, and then move on out and gives us more space, and then it breaks out ramps.
No, I meant three separate stages like this. Take it.
Okay, there's three separate crews.
Take it, Kirk.
There's a
three complete system.
Exactly. Yeah, there's three stages, and right now in Giant Stadium, which is tomorrow's gig, the stage there is being constructed. And for the third show, once this show is over, everything
from the A system
from this set is going to go to the third show, which is in Detroit. So that's how that works.
So I'm sure that we're
way to go, man.
We're all completely confused.
It's a whole different thing because Guns N' Roses are using a separate staging as far as ramps and lights and that stuff. You know, they have their whole show, and Metallica has their whole show with different lights and different staging and all that stuff. So that's what I thought you were trying to get at, you know.
It's a totally different,
I just want everybody to
know. Yeah, when everybody's seeing the
shows
it's not least sharing the stage. You've got Metallica stage and Guns N' Roses stage.
Exactly. Two totally separate things.
Killer. We'll be back right now. Let's watch Enter Sandman from Metallica. Stage with Faith No More at RFK in Washington, D.C. This is the first show of the Whirlwind Tour that's going on for... How long is it going on for? A
couple months, as far as I know.
And this, the other bands, I mean, they've had albums out for a while, but this is really your first tour with a new album, right?
Yeah.
In America?
It's kind of strange because, I mean, when you do a record, you usually expect to kind of start from the ground up, and starting out with a tour like this is a little... awkward.
Yeah, and so this is also your first response to see what the American audience thinks about the new record live, right?
America, yeah. We've been a couple months in Europe, and they seem to like it not very much. Hopefully, America.
how is Faith No More received over there?
Pretty well, actually. We got a good following. It was the same thing over there, though. We were touring with Guns N' Roses, so it's hard to like really gauge. You know, are you guys really here to see us, or are you here to see that red-haired guy and his troop of clowns? So, you know, it's hard to say.
Yeah, it's impossible when you open for people to know who likes you and what for what reasons they're there.
But it seemed like the response, like, for the people that are out there today, they just want to see a lot of good music because, I mean, a lot of people are Guns, Faith, and Metallica fans.
Let's get real here. I think all they want to do is throw underwear at us.
But you also asked for the underwear, so.
Exactly.
Yeah, people were throwing clothes up there. You, like, got a good clothes collection today?
I just think it's us reaching out to the crowd, you know.
It's that bonding thing. You perform for them, they throw out clothes.
Boy, do they reach to us today. A lot of reaching going on.
Did you see those hands?
I saw the hands in the clothes.
They're going something like this.
And with that, let's play a video from Guns N' Roses.
And hi, Peter. And he said to me, there's these guys in this new band called Guns N' Roses before the record came out, before Appetite came out. There's these guys in LA that you gotta hook up with because they have the same attitude and you guys will get along with them really well. So we hooked up with Slash and stuff way before their first record came out.
This is something very Spinal Tap about this whole thing.
We're good friends with those guys and stuff, and we've got it worked out, so it's gonna be a cool thing for everybody. It's not gonna be like Guns N' Roses is headlining and Metallica's opening. It's going to be, you know, Metallica and Guns N' Roses. And, you know, they're going to do their full set. We're going to do our full set. And then, who knows what will happen after the end of that. It'll probably be something cool.
So is this dance around 7?
Hey, John. And that's going to be followed by a half hour of live performance videos from Metallica. Now, showing a big stadium tour like this and knowing where you guys started, I mean, it's quite amazing, the big rise of Metallica and this type of music. Why do you think that Metallica has become such a super group and that people are becoming more accessible to this type of music?
Because we won't go away. We won't go away. We keep on coming to everyone's towns. We keep on getting played on stations and MTV.
Open it up, man.
That's it.
Because, I mean, because of your success, it has opened the doors for a lot more heavier metal, you know, hating using the term heavy metal, but for a lot of other metal bands.
I think, I heard Kirk say the other day, it's kind of a thing, the way that it snowballed, you know, and gained momentum, and it just keeps going and going and going, and like this album, people were ready to hear a bit more of an edge, and we were a bit, you know, we were ready to give them our music that was, you know, still accessible, but still had the edge too. You know, they were ready to hear it. We were ready to play it. It kind of worked out good.
It was all in finding a balance, you know, between those things, those two factors that Jason just spoke about, and you know, just finding where we can still like keep that initial aggression and energy while making the music a little bit more easier to understand, and evidently we did something right because things are happening. And, you know, now I see a trend. I see a lot of other heavy metal bands following suit and, like, you know, stripping down their sound and making things a little bit more concise.
Bringing the vocals out and all that stuff, you know, different things. But that's kind of how it's been in the past years, you know.
They see something that works.
And especially in Metallica's vein, you know, and they kind of go after that thing, kind of, you know, always have been the leaders for that type of music.
Right, breaking the ice.
Yep. We're going to be back at RFK, Unleashing the Monster, Guns N' Roses, and Metallica. And right now, here's a video from Metallica. Here's Wherever I May Roam.
Metallica right there, James right there, doing the song that actually attracted me to Metallica, Seek and Destroy. I think the first, probably coolest song done by Metallica. I dig it. Anyway, we'll be back, and when we come back, we're going to be talking to Lars, the drummer of Metallica. But right now, let's watch a video. You might recognize the guy going, it's me. Here's Guns N' Roses, November Rain. We'll be back at RFK, Washington, D.C., part of the killer show ever.
Family back here at RFK. Bye.
Bye. Bye, Mom.
Back onto the subway to the next show. They don't tell you that you get the jet. And keep on talking. Hey, you gotta take the subway to the show. Anyways, want to remind you the Metallica rockumentary is coming up at 4:30, and you just saw it. And what do you think?
Hey, I just saw our first Metallica rockumentary, and you know what? It's actually really cool.
Very cool. And is it kind of weird to see the whole thing? I mean, it kind of all sums it up from the very beginnings, and here you are backstage at RFK after playing, you know, a sold-out show.
It's always funny to see, I mean, a lot of those old pictures and hear those old stories and stuff like that over and again. It was cool. I don't look at it that nostalgic. Well, gee, there it was, and now here we are. Have we finally arrived? But I mean, it was cool seeing the rockumentary. It was fun seeing a lot of the old stuff, and I got a little misty-eyed at one point. And it was cool. Definitely happening.
It was real good. Definitely catch it at 4:30. We're gonna be back talking to Lars backstage at RFK in Washington, D.C. So stick around, okay? So my reason. I mean, you look like you're pretty burnt. I mean, how was it up there?
I was sitting up on stage and I looked up, they had this like temperature gauge or thingy, whatever, up there. I look up, it's like it's 105 degrees, it's sitting on the thing. I'm going like, why am I doing this? Isn't this stuff dangerous to do? It's like, but you know, the first time, 45 minutes we played, we were still in daylight, and the first like three songs, we had the sun like blaring in our eyes, and it was a good show. I mean, 2 hours and 15 minutes, but the first like hour was rough. I'm like really burnt, so now I'm gonna go down and like get some of that for about 8 or 9 good hours.
But it was nice when the sun went down, because then it was nice to a chilly 101. So You made it in my
I mean, it's great. I always love playing that slot where you just, you start when it's still daylight, and then you get the whole transformation into like nighttime and stuff. It's great playing right at twilight and stuff like that. So I'm really happy with the slot that we have here, and it's cool. But, you know, I'm like completely wasted now.
There's another thing I wanted to talk about, the appeal of Metallica, that we'll talk a little bit later on. And you'll find out a lot more about Metallica in the Metallica Rockumentary, which is in about... how long? 20 minutes or something?
That's what it says on the card there. Yeah,
see, so. You blew the whole thing. We're just supposed to be talking about this off the cuff. Anyways, right now we're going to play some commercials, and then we're going to be coming back for Metallica and Guns Unleashing the Monster. Stick around. Here at RFK in Washington, D.C. with Faith No More, and these guys just got off stage. And this tour goes... across America, most of your bigger stadiums, I'm sure if it's coming by you, you know about it already. Are there any cities that you're really looking forward to playing?
New Orleans.
New Orleans is...
play there.
Oh, you've never played there?
We have, but a long time ago, I guess.
Because New Orleans is a pretty sick place.
Sick?
I mean that in a good way.
What do you mean by that?
Have you been to New Orleans? Don't you think New Orleans has got like a certain vibe to it? I mean, I hate saying that word because it sounds kind of weird.
No, I think it's a beautiful city. I think you've watched too many movies.
No, I've been in New Orleans. That's why I'm saying that.
All right.
And I do have watched too many movies. Anyways, we were talking about the tour, going out to all the towns. Now, is this like, I know a lot of tours, you play a show and then the next day you've got to play a show. Do you have a lot of downtime? I mean, are there a couple days off between shows?
Yeah, it's pretty cushy. Like, we'll play a show and then have a couple days off.
It's actually really good because we get to go around to the cities that we're playing in and actually see them rather than just seeing the gig in the hotel, right, which is what you usually see,
right,
when you play six nights a week. You have to drive to the next city the next day.
Now, after
this is a really typical rock conversation, isn't it?
What could be more fun?
It's like going to gig, the hotel. It's so typical this day.
What do you guys have planned after this stadium tour? Because you've got the new album, so I imagine you're going to go out and promote that for a while. You know?
Afterwards, yeah, we're going to do our own show. We haven't done them forever, so.
We're trying to pick out bands to play to open up for us on
the
a tour by ourselves.
What type of bands
there
are there?
Bands,
you know,
that's
what it seems
nobody.
Like? I mean, obviously, with Faith No More success, there are a lot of bands that are doing the Faith No More type of thing out there, and I know that you guys see it all the time.
No.
Sure.
Really, then I don't think many bands are doing that. We try to go for someone like, we try to get Right Said Fred to do a tour with us, and they're kind of busy. And we're trying for like people really unlike what we're doing. Like, we try to get D-Light to do it, but they're a little bit costly. A lot of different factors come into play.
Usually the costly one is the most important one.
So as opposed to being great and expensive, somebody that's just good and kind of cheap now.
No, it's just the hardest thing is just finding a good band that wants to do it.
Right.
Nobody wants to play with us.
Uh-oh. Well,
I can't really.
Any of you good bands, they're looking for you. Right now, let's play a video from Faith No More. Here is Falling to Pieces. Stage with Lars, Metallica. In half an hour, you're going to see live Metallica videos. What in the hell are you doing?
There's a backstage pass. Wanted to check it.
They'll give him, wanted to check it because he was about to throw me out, right? Look him to anybody. Anyways. We're going to play some live Metallica videos in just a little bit. And how did this show stand out as being one of your live shows?
This was number 214 out of 814 shows we've done. This was actually not a bad show. My expectations for this is the first show we've done in a couple of weeks. First show, the stadium thing. It was about, you know, 400 degrees up on stage. And I thought that we'd pull it off pretty well. I was very happy with today's performance, but knowing that also it's going to get better as we go along and get more into the stadium thing and so on.
Doing good, and thanks for taking the time to talk with us. And right now, why don't you tell us what we're about to show?
Hey, in 30 minutes.
No, we're not going to play that.
Oh,
in 30 minutes.
It's right there.
Of course, in 30 minutes, you're going to see some live Metallica videos. But what are we going to show right now?
Oh, we're going to play. It's the Mega Metallica Rockumentary, dude. It's 30 minutes of everything that you never knew about Metallica. Well, you probably might know some of the things. But,
actually, you probably knew most of it, but now you're going to find out, and it's really good, and you're going to enjoy it. I did.
And it's really well put together by somebody named Nancy.
Check it out. Very cool. That was the Metallica Rockumentary, and we're about to play some live Metallica videos, including one that you haven't seen on MTV, which is, I'm stoked because I haven't even seen this, and obviously it was a concert that was in Moscow, so I wasn't even there.
This is Fade to Black, which was obviously, like you said, from the gig, which was the last gig on the European tour we did with AC/DC. Moscow, there was about, you know, 14 zillion people there, and the one thing I just want to tell you guys is that there's been a lot of people who think that this song advocates suicide or promotes suicide. We've had some flack in the newspapers for that, and obviously anybody who knows about Metallica knows that that's obviously not the case. We're never trying to promote or sell anything like that. And the one thing that it always annoys me about the media is that they, the one or two incidents where something bad has happened with this song, Fade to Black, they never talk about all the kids that always come up to us backstage and send us letters and stuff like that and say how the song Fade to Black really changed their lives and helped them through some really bad times and really made a difference in their lives and stuff like that. So this is Fade to Black from Moscow, and actually this song is also part of a home video that's coming out called For Those About to Rock in Moscow or something like that. It's features us and AC/DC and the Black Crowes and Pantera and a bunch of other cool bands, and should be coming out soon, so check it out. This is Fade to Black. We're Metallica, and this is filmed in Moscow, and it's actually pretty cool.
That was Fade to Black from Metallica playing live in Moscow, and that's from the home video For Those About to Rock, Monsters in Moscow. Look for it soon in your local video store. And we're about to play Enter Sandman, which is you guys completely different from Moscow, playing live at the 1991 MTV Video Music Awards.
Capitalistic LA, yeah. It was, actually that gig was in the middle. We were doing like the 7 weeks of the Monsters of Rock in Europe with AC/DC, and in the middle of that, we had like 3 days off, and both us and actually Queensryche jetted over to play at the Universal thingy and do the MTV Awards, and then like we were back on a plane the next morning and back playing in like Munich, Germany or Frankfurt or something, and this was, I think this is our second ever live appearance on TV. We'd done the Grammys a couple of years before, and I was really happy with the way this MTV Awards came out. And this is Enter Sandman. This is right when we were like our fourth week at number one in America. It was great to be back.
And it's coming up on the way, Enter Sandman from the 1991 MTV Video Music Awards, so stick around.
In Philly.
And what about the Concert for Life? Because we're about to play a video from that.
That was a lot of fun. It was great because it was just wonderful day just to hang out and meet all
the ass. That's another way of putting it. Let's play a live video from that. Here's Nothing Else Matters from Metallica at a Concert for Life. Well, that's it for tonight's show. Let me tell you a couple things. When you go to a show like this, cool out, because it's fun to have a really good time, but you got to remember, if you're cool and everything goes great, then it's going to make it possible for more huge hard rock shows like this to come to your town. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the management, labels, and the bands, Guns N' Roses, Metallica, and Faith No More. They were all great. The show was amazing. It's the type of show that you just sweat and just burn calories just going to a show like this. I also want to thank all the people from RFK and all the people from Washington, D.C., good people here in Washington. Anyways, next Saturday, Ugly Kid Joe is going to be hosting Headbangers Ball. I'm going to Hawaii on a vacation. I'll come back all tan and rested, and after a show like this, you actually do need to rest. I'm Ricky Rackman. I had a blast. Thanks for hanging out with us. Remember, check out this show when it comes to your town. See if there's tickets available. It's a reality. Guns N' Roses, Metallica, Faith.
Now we take you on stage and backstage at the 7.5-hour kickoff show by GNR, Metallica, and Faith No More in the nation's capital.
It's been anticipated as the biggest tour of the summer. Co-headliners Guns N' Roses and Metallica, along with opening act Faith No More, began their trek across America at Washington, D.C.'s RFK Stadium last week. The show was a major success, despite, among other challenges, the very intense heat.
Well, I was sitting up on stage and I looked up, they had this like temperature gauge or thing and whatever up there. I look up, and it's like it's 105 degrees it's sitting on the thing. I'm going like, why am I doing this? Isn't this stuff dangerous to do?
With each act only a few weeks off from their last tour leg, getting the music right is one aspect of this show that nobody is worried about. Guns N' Roses says they're so well oiled that the band needed only a single day of preparation, and that without singer Axl Rose, to rehearse a few oldies for the tour. Axl had no concerns about missing the practice.
Once the music's there, it's kind of like getting in a car and driving it when the car is completely tuned and it's running well and you know how to drive the car. It's like when the band's got the song down, I know the song.
With Faith No More opening the show in the afternoon and Guns N' Roses closing well after midnight, Metallica's middle slot puts them in the unusual position of playing under both sun and lights at the same gig.
You start when it's still daylight and then you get the whole transformation into like nighttime and stuff. It's great playing right at twilight and stuff like that. So I'm really happy with the slot that we have here, and it's cool.
only low energy point in this 7.5 hour extravaganza takes place after Metallica's set ends. That's when the great juggling act of getting Metallica's enormous customized stage off and Guns N' Roses' enormous customized stage on begins.
You know, the set change between us and Metallica is 1 hour and 15 because, I mean, they're both big productions, and instead of turning the stage around like most bands do, we have to take down the Metallica stuff and put our stuff up, and it takes a long time. So by the time we get on, unfortunately, most of the kids are burnt out.
The band certainly aren't burnt out, and that's a good thing because nobody here will be getting rest anytime soon. Both Metallica and Guns N' Roses will return to their own tours in the fall. But for now, this mega tour marches on, a testament, the band say, to their no-compromise careers.
It's more of an accomplishment to get all these bands who are so much against the system and against the industry standards and pull it together and make it the biggest thing of the summer. I mean, there's a sense of accomplishment. So yeah, you're excited.
Guns N' Roses, Metallica, and Faith No More will play the Indianapolis Hoosier Dome on Wednesday and Rich Stadium in Buffalo, New York on Saturday. Some tickets for both shows are still available at $27.50 each.
For every single gig. Whether we play for an hour and a half to 3 hours, regardless, you know, every single song has to mean something at that moment. So the intensity is really just in the band itself.
There have been times when Guns N' Roses actually were ready to hit the stage at showtime, but those are rare and treasured events.
For the first time at Giant Stadium, we were actually ready to go and the stage wasn't up yet. All of us were like standing around. Yeah, that was an unprecedented event.
Guns N' Roses and Company will be playing the Foxborough Theater near Boston on Friday, but that show is completely sold out. Some tickets are still available, however, at $27.50 each for Sunday's Guns and Metallica concert in Columbia, South Carolina.